Well, again, happy Easter. It's great to hear the waters of baptism flowing. Hope it reminds all of us not that we need to use the restroom, but that the Lord is blessing us with these abundant waters of baptism. You know, this past Easter, we had 18 people come into the church. That's amazing. COVID, what? Christ, yes? You know what I'm saying? It's like 18 people. And as I bragged about that with all these Padres over Easter, maybe there were churches that had, you know, great groupings that had more than us, but I don't know of any, maybe. It doesn't matter. That was so beautiful to see and be a part of the great onslaught of that. And so on Easter, I was just reflecting on the fact that we had 18 people come and started to think back to a moment in my own life where I got to see somebody come into the church. And what a blessing it is, right? So I have this brother-in-law of mine. His name is Will, and he only has 8 kids with my sister. And those are the only 8 kids that he has. And so he's the first to marry into the grandchildren part of the family, of which now there's 153, thanks to baby Joseph. There's still 9 on the way this year. So I was going to World Youth Day in Australia, in Sydney, and this was in 2008, like mid-July. And he had called me a couple days before I went, and he told me about his sister, Carrie. Carrie had been in Australia because she was an accomplished horseback rider, somebody who had actually been a part of the U.S. equestrian team for the Olympics. And she'd stayed on in Australia. She had gotten severely sick, and a lot of the organs in her body were slowly expiring. She was living in a different part of Australia, and when Will called me, he said that she'd been in a coma for several days and was being rushed over to a hospital in Sydney. And he had told me where it was. So when I landed in Sydney, I went right to the hospital. And at the time, I didn't know this, but her mom had been there by her side during the whole coma incident. And so when I walked into the hospital, her mom had left because there was nobody in the room. And I walked in, I sat down, started to pray, and she woke up, which was a huge surprise because I had heard that basically she was in a coma. And when she woke up, unfortunately, she saw me. You know, she didn't see like something more extravagant. But at any rate, I started to explain to her who I was. And, you know, unfortunately, the color in her face had changed to just a really really challenging look. And she was a beautiful woman, but you could tell that with all the things that had gone on, she was losing slowly her capacities. And so we started to talk a little bit. And then she started to ask about Jesus. And so we started to talk about the faith, and I realized she hadn't been baptized, she hadn't received the sacraments. And so we just started to talk about all that. And as the time went on in Australia there, I would go back and forth between World Youth Day and visiting her until we finally got to baptize her. She got to receive reconciliation, First Communion, Confirmation, anointing of the sick. And when all those things happened, right when she finished that, she goes, "I want to call my brother." Because Will was still in the United States. Oh, she was in Australia. Well, there's family. And she calls her brother and she goes, "Will, I'm Catholic." And that would be her last phone call to her brother. And just not much longer after that, she would die. And as I was reflecting upon what Will did for me as a brother-in-law, inviting me to go see his sister in Australia, and then being able to be a part of seeing somebody come into the faith, be able to reconcile themselves with Jesus, bring their woundedness, everything that she had, her whole body was deteriorating, and allow the love of the Lord to be kind of intermingled with her wounds. And then to see her be able to smile and tell her brother that she was Catholic. It's so much like what Jesus is asking of us right now. To know that those wounds of Jesus that he wants to show us, those are his trophies. And his trophies are not just the wounds that he received in his nails. His trophies are your wounds. They're my wounds. They're the wounds of those people around us. And my brother-in-law had that insight. He knew that his sister was hurting, that she was not doing well. And what did he ask for but a priest to go be there, to somebody accompany her in this, because he knew he couldn't get there at that time. And so he asked me to be that instrument. And I am so grateful and I'm so blessed that I have a brother-in-law who thinks like that for his sister. And how many people in our lives perhaps need to have their wounds tended to by the resurrection of Jesus, where they can just share their wounds? You know, I often think of this little crucifix that was given just the other day, and there's a little slit in the side of Jesus. And I often wonder, isn't that the real FedEx package that we need to be sending off through this little mailbox? The little slit in the side of Jesus, the wounds of Jesus, are where we need to send, like a FedEx package, as soon as we can, express to Jesus and give it to him. How many people are out there in our lives that we need to invite to be able to probe the wounds of Jesus in their doubt, in their darkness, first starting with ourselves and those and the people around us? It is the most life-saving message we could ever have. Yes, it's good. You know, I just got news that somebody has COVID, and that's awful. We need to pray for them. We need to help them out medically. Absolutely, they need to get the best care possible. But that's secondary to the ultimate goal of the ultimate care of Jesus, who wants us to bring people to him in the resurrection, in this time. You hear that passage and you say, Jesus says, peace be with you. The peace that Jesus brings to us is not that the logistics are going to work out, that the Pirates are going to win on opening day. It's not going to be that the Penguins will, you know, win every game from here on out. It's not going to be that we're going to get the job that we want. It's not going to be that our, you know, our nephew or nieces are going to get into the college they want. That's not normally the type of quote-unquote peace that Jesus is talking about. What Jesus is talking about is connecting with the ultimate peace, which is outside of time and space. And we can start doing that now because of the resurrection. You see, Jesus does not come back the way he left us. He's not. The reason why we need to probe his wounds is because his wounds are there, but they're different than they were on Good Friday. The Good Friday Jesus is different than the Easter Sunday Jesus. And all of us need to be the same. We can walk around like a Good Friday Jesus with wounds and bleeding. Great. Fester in that day. That's not what we're supposed to do. Jesus invited us to go to the Easter Sunday Jesus. And so many times we just get stuck in the Good Friday as if it was a Groundhog Day. But we're not supposed to be stuck in that day. We're supposed to allow the Lord to encounter us, taking our wounds and the wounds of those others to the resurrected Jesus, because that's a different Jesus. Why would he ask to eat with them? Why would he be able to come through a wall and then be present to them and then have them touch these wounds? He's not the Good Friday Jesus. He's the Easter Sunday Jesus. And that's where we need to send our wounds and the wounds of our loved ones, and take our loved ones tenderly to experience what it is like to touch Jesus. And that's what he's inviting us to do during this Easter octave. We have 8 days to do this. It's like there's this urgency right now to reach out to somebody today who needs to be able to take their wounds and be cared for by the resurrected Jesus. Because let's face it, we need peace. And peace does not come from like a lack of war. It doesn't come from, you know, everybody holding hands, singing kumbaya, you know. It really doesn't. It comes from us reconciling through Jesus ourselves with God and the world around us. It comes from us having the courage to, yes, go through Good Friday, but to live in Easter Sunday with Jesus. It was crazy on Easter Sunday as I was thinking about this amazing experience with Carrie and with my dear brother-in-law, Will. He never got to make it over to Australia. He was flying there, and he made it to California. And in some sense, Carrie had told me she didn't want her brother to see her like this, because of the illness and the state that she was physically in. And so her brother got to California. He had the tension of he wanted to see her before she died. He was on his way, but didn't get there. And so he got that call when he was in California. And it's interesting, right? So he got his wish of trying to be with his sister. She got her wish of him not being able to see her, right? But in the resurrection on the last day, what will Will see in his sister in heaven? But the glorified, the most beautiful, the tender image of his dear sister and her body and soul united in the glory of heaven. And he will be able to see her more beautiful, more splendid than any moment in her life. Because that is the taste that we need to have today, the feel that we need to have, that we were made gloriously in the gloriousness of who we are, even in our woundedness. It's going to be tasted in heaven. And so on Easter Sunday, this past Easter Sunday, I was exhausted. I don't know. I think I did a mass in Spanish at 4 o'clock on Easter Sunday. I really don't know what I said at that mass. And as I was driving out of Ambridge, I was just going down and I noticed that there was very little gas in my car. And I'm thinking, oh my goodness, I got to go get a gas station. I was probably not too awake at the time. And I pull over. I was in Bellevue at this point on the High River Boulevard, right near the McDonald's. And pull up to the gas station. I remember I didn't know what gas station I was going to. I just pulled up there. And I'm filling the gas tank. And you know who pulls up next to me? Carrie's dad. And I just, you know, just like, yeah, that's what happens. Amen?